Subsession on algebraic data structures. This is joint work with my advisor Danu Ponnanonkai. And in the previous talk, I kind of motivated why polynomial matrices are important for graph data structures. What I want to convey now is that if you happen to analyze polynomial matrices, one way is to reduce to classic integral matrices where we have actual numbers in them. But if you do that, you might miss some interesting properties that could be exploited. So try to actually work with polynomial matrices and not with integral ones. All right, so part one, model and result. What kind of data structure are we analyzing? We are considering the following dynamic algorithm. It's kind of a batch distance data structure. Here, after some initial preprocessing of a graph, the data structure must support update operations and query operations. The update operations allow for adding or removing an edge, and the query operation there, let's say we query the data structure, then we must also specify two sets of nodes, I and J, and then the data structure will tell us all the distances between start nodes in I and target nodes in T. So we kind of get this submatrix of the distance matrix, like here, when we specify, let's say, this is I and J. All right. This seems a bit like an unusual model. What's this about? So this is actually just a generalization that captures many important problems. So let's look, for example, at ST distance. If you want to maintain ST distance, then that's really just, well, we pick S as our set I and T as our set J, and then we get the ST distance. Likewise, if you want to maintain single source distances, then we just pick our single source as our set I and say J are all the other nodes, and then we get the single source distances. And single source distances are actually one of the major open problems in the area of graph data structures. The problem is, can we beat n square update time? And there are a bunch of lower bounds. So Aboud and Wasilewska-Williams have shown that you must use fast matrix multiplication because any combinatorial algorithm is bound to need n squared time just for ST distance already. Also, if your result is exact, it maintains exact distances, then you're bound to need n squared time update time as well. Okay. And yeah, this model also captures a bunch of other special cases. It's known, for example, that if you can maintain the distances for roughly root n many sources, then you get a 1.5 approximation of the diameter. Also, we could just compute all pair distances by just saying I and J are all the nodes in our graph. And there too exist some open problems that I want to talk about later. So first, let's look at our result. Watch out, it looks a bit scary. So we have this 1 plus epsilon approximate distance data structure for this batch distance problem here. And unfortunately, the update time cannot be further simplified than this term, unless omega, so fast matrix multiplication happens to run in n squared time. And yeah, the main point here is that we can kind of trade off between update and query time, and we heavily use fast matrix multiplication. Let's just look at some examples on what this update time really means. Let's start with single source distances. Well, a trivial solution to solving single source distances would be just whenever someone asks for the distance, run Dijkstra's algorithm. On dense graphs, it might need something like n squared time. So the question is, can we beat just trivially running Dijkstra every time? And as I already said, there are some lower bounds that say no, it's probably not possible unless you use fast matrix multiplication and approximation. But that's exactly what our data structure does. So if we pick I and J to be the single node and J to be all the nodes, then we get single source distances, and we actually maintain the distances in better than n squared time. So that's one of the major open problems in graph data structures solved. Okay, another open problem is how to get n square all pair distances. So we already know by Dimitrescu and Italiano that if we allow amortization, so if we look at the average update time, then we can maintain this in n square update time. However, it could be that for this algorithm, some of the updates need a lot more time than n square. So the question is, can we also get n square as a worst case bound? And there are a bunch of results for that, but they are far off n square time, unfortunately. And now if we look at our algorithm, then, well, if we pick I and j to be all the nodes and just plug this into our upper bound and check what does omega yield, then for weighted directed graphs, we almost reach n square. So unfortunately, fast matrix multiplication is not fast enough yet. If someone works on this, please work harder. And for unweighted undirected graphs, then we actually manage to get n square worst case update time. All right. Then let's look at the last application, diameter or other extremal distances. How can we maintain the diameter? So that's the largest distance we can find in our graph. What we could do is just maintain the distance matrix and look for the largest entry. That's kind of the trivial solution. Another trivial solution would be to run a static algorithm. Just every time our graph changes, run the static algorithm again. There is this algorithm by Roditi and Wasilewska-Williams that have shown that if you have roughly root n single sources, then you can get a 1.5 approximation of the diameter. And if you want to beat n square update time for the diameter, it's also known that there is a lower bound that you must have at least 1.5 approximation. And if you have a better approximation than 1.5, then you must use at least n square update time. And there is one dynamic algorithm that has this type of approximation, but this is an incremental and decremental algorithm. So this one does not support both insertions and deletions at the same time. Okay, and now since we just need to compute root n single sources, we can just plug this into our algorithm again. What happens if we do some kind of batch query for root n sources, and then we again manage to get better than n square update time for diameter? And you can use the same idea also to approximate the radius or the eccentricities. Okay, so the summary is that there are these open problems, better than n square single source, worst case n square all pair distances, and better than n square for maintaining the diameter, and we managed to answer all of these open questions. Okay, so how does our algorithm work? First of all, what we want to do is focus just on single source distances, just to not be too general. And let's say, instead of approximating single source distances on weighted graphs, there is a chain of reductions that is very common in graph data structures that allows us to reduce it to maintaining approximate h-hop distances. So every path uses at most h steps. And we now need many sources, n over h many. And it can also be an unweighted graph for that, for this problem. Okay, so how can we solve this new problem? We want to maintain 1 plus epsilon approximate n over h many sources with h-hop distances. And so far, all of the reductions are purely graph theoretic. But the lower bound says it must use fast matrix multiplication. It must be some algebraic data structure. So what can we do? There is an algorithm by Sankowski for exact distances, where he reduces this problem to, again, maintaining the inverse of some polynomial matrix. The inverse also contains polynomials. And we maintain this modulo x to the h because we're only interested in h-hop distances. So you can think of it as this is our inverse, and every entry is some polynomial, and we can just truncate the degree to be at most h minus 1. And now we need to maintain a large submatrix of size n over h times n, let's say this large blue block. And how Sankowski did that was he reduced this to the classic integral matrix, where we have actual numbers instead of polynomials, which is an intuitive thing to do, right? Because polynomial matrices are a bit weird. Unfortunately, there's a problem here. So if we maintain this large blue block, then that's already going to give us an n square bottleneck, because these are n square over h many entries, but every entry is a polynomial of degree h, so just the amount of numbers that we compute here is already n square. So there's no way we can get subquadratic single source distances from this. So what we did is we modified the reduction a bit and said, okay, let's look at really this approximate case. And we see that what happens now is that we don't need to maintain the entire polynomials. We just need to maintain the coefficients of x to the k, where k is close to some power of 1 plus epsilon. So in a sense, if this blue block here represents this entire polynomial, so like a sequence of h numbers, then we are now only computing these log h many green bars, which now allows us to break this n square bottleneck for this large blue block here, because we no longer have n square many numbers to compute. And the problem here is that this cannot be solved by reducing to integral matrices, because in a sense what we do here is we compute like a subset of these monomials, but there is not really a subset of a number, at least not from an algebraic perspective. You either have the number or you don't have it. What's a subset of a number? All right. So the summary here is that previously when polynomial matrices were studied in the dynamic setting, it was always just in the way of reducing to integral matrices, and then the integral matrices were studied because they're more intuitive, but this leads to an n-square bottleneck. And now the new way is to, we define this incomplete polynomial matrix inverse because we don't compute all the coefficients of these polynomials, and there is no equivalent to integral matrices, so we really have to work with polynomial matrices directly. All right. So how does our algorithm work? The main idea is to use the Sherman, Morrison, Woodbury identity again. Let's say this M0 is our matrix during the preprocessing, with where the zero means that there were zero updates so far. Right? And now this is the matrix MT, which means it's the matrix after T entries of this matrix were changed. Now the Sherman-Morrison-Woodbury identity tells us that we can write this new inverse by the old inverse plus this product here. And here U and V are just matrices that are of size T times N, so that corresponds to the number of updates so far. And the columns of U and V correspond to some columns and rows of the inverse during the preprocessing. So we know this matrix, and we can know all of these rows and columns just from the preprocessing. The issue is that this W is going to cause a bit of trouble. What we do is we create a new modified Sherman, Morrison, Woodbury identity that doesn't have this W matrix. But what changes is that now for U, the ith column corresponds to a column of the M inverse after I minus one many updates. So it becomes a bit harder to maintain this, but that too can be solved. And now the question is, okay, why is this useful to have this new identity here? The thing is that, right, we don't need the entire inverse. We just want to have the coefficients of some x to the k. So let's say we want to compute of this matrix the coefficients of some x to the k. That means we need to have the coefficients of x to the k of this matrix and of this product. We can assume we know already the coefficients of this matrix because that's known from the preprocessing. We can just compute this initially. So how do we compute the coefficients here? And that's that we do that this way. So let's say u and then this exponent in brackets k means that these are the coefficients of x to the k, which means the matrix u can be written in this way. Now, just by definition of how polynomial products work, this means the kth coefficient of this product uv is this sum here. And this sum has the nice property that we can write it as a matrix product. Right? Now, if we multiply a row with a column here, we always multiply like the u0 with the vk term, exactly as required by this sum. So we can kind of perform this polynomial matrix product by using fast matrix multiplication, and it turns out this is actually faster than using fast Fourier transforms, since we only need to, the coefficients of like 1x to the k, not all the coefficients. That's kind of the high-level idea how this works. I don't think I have what's the time?
6 minutes.
6 minutes. Oh, okay, well then I have time for this, good. So there are further improvements possible. So one thing is that common in dynamic algorithms is that after you have gotten many updates, the data structure becomes kind of slow. That also happens here because, in a sense, U and V, right? These are matrices of size T times N, where T is the number of updates so far. So if you have many updates, then U and V are very large matrices. But then if you want to multiply if you want to use this trick of computing some coefficient of UV via this matrix multiplication, then that becomes really slow. So a common trick in data structures is to just say, well, pick some trade-off parameter mu and say after n to the mu updates, just reinitialize, start from scratch. So when we do this, then one observation is that, okay, we kind of need to recompute this inverse here. And usually that needs a lot of time because this is like a large matrix. But the point is we never need all of the coefficients, right? Of this M0, we only need the coefficients that are close to some power of 1 plus epsilon. That's by definition of our incomplete matrix inverse. So what we can do is we can speed up our reinitialization by just computing the coefficients of this inverse that are close to some power of 1 plus epsilon. This, however, leads to the problem of how do we get this U and V matrix? Because they correspond to some, like, we need to know all the coefficients of U and V, and they correspond to some past entry of the inverse. So we kind of need to know all of the coefficients of the inverse anyway. And the trick is to just run Sankovsky's algorithm. So we have here our incomplete matrix inverse problem. And we can just reduce this, it's not a reduction, but we can maintain the matrix U and V by running Sankovsky's algorithm for just one column per query. And that's interesting because in a sense, what we are solving here is like many source approximate H hop distances. But what Sankovsky's algorithm does is it solves exact single source H hop distances. So in a sense, we kind of get a fast approximate algorithm for many sources by running internally an algorithm that gets us exact distances for just one single source. And that's a bit surprising that this is possible from this algebraic perspective. At least I'm not sure how to otherwise get this from the graph theoretic perspective. And intuitively, this it can still be fast because, well, this is a large output size, this is a small output size. So even though this exact algorithm is kind of slow, we never need a lot of information from it. Okay, so that kind of is the summary of how our data structure works. So we create some new Sherman-Morrison-Woodbury identity where the matrices U and V are maintained by using Sankovsky's algorithm. And whenever we need some coefficient of this product, UV transpose, we can use that, we can compute that using fast matrix multiplication. And whenever we reset, we just compute some few coefficients of this M0 inverse. Okay. So summary of this talk. We have this new distance data structure that's very general, like it can support many different types of query. It's only approximate, like the results are only 1 plus epsilon approximate. But it still manages to answer many open problems for like single source, APSP, and diameter. And the main improvement comes from the fact that we analyze these polynomial matrices directly, so we don't use too much graph theory. And yeah, open problems would be, well, we just have approximate APSP. Could there be an n-square worst-case APSP algorithm that is exact? Alternatively, we always use fast matrix multiplication. Is it possible to have a combinatorial worst case APSP algorithm with n square? For single source distances, we know there's this lower bound that says, no, you must use fast matrix multiplication. But for APSP, it's still open. Then for approximate single source distances, there is no lower bound for that. We managed to break this n square upper bound, but there's we have no idea how fast could this theoretically be. Is there some lower bound for approximate single source distances? And at the end, like in the previous talk, I can just maintain the distances. We cannot maintain the path itself, so that would be interesting to figure out how to actually return a path for all of these distances. Okay, thank you.